Royal Babylon. The Criminal Record of the British Monarchy. An investigative poem by Heathcote Williams. Comfort of the rich depends upon an abundant supply of the poor. Voltaire. In 1840, Pierre-Joseph Proudhon, the first self-declared anarchist, defined anarchy in What is Property as the absence of a master, of a sovereign. In the year of the Queen's Jubilee, tourists peered as usual through the railings of Buckingham Palace, but her fairy tale was fading. The Fairy Queen's wings were being clipped by the Sex Pistols, putting monarchy in their sights. God save the Queen, they sang. It's a fascist regime. And the song's hook line became a new anthem, disturbing to clutches of flag wavers lining the streets, and horrifying to Middle England and the Daily Mail. The Sex Pistols proclaimed, "She ain't no human being," and their subversive posters for the record placed the band's salacious name right across the Queen's lips, and they masked her eyes with two spidery swastikas. Sang, "I don't believe illusions, 'cause too much is real." They accessorized the Queen's nose with safety pins, like a voodoo doll, and covered her face with cut-out letters, as if presenting the world with a kidnapper's note. "Oh no," people would say, "you can't have a go at the Queen," sucking their breath in to indicate caution. "Oh no, not the Queen. The Queen's above politics, you see. They can't answer back, can they? So it's not fair." Then they'd earnestly claim, "It's in the Constitution, isn't it?" Forgetting that Britain's never had such a document. For the Brits, despite their inordinate pride in their own history, often reveal they know less about it than anyone. By 1993, the Duke of Edinburgh, the owner of 56 shooting rifles, had brought down 30,000 birds from the skies. He'd killed two crocodiles, as well as scores of wild boar, several hundred Scottish stags, and an Indian tiger. The Duke of Edinburgh's accumulation of animal corpses, piled up over the past 40 years, ranges widely over continents, covering mammals and birds for the Tweedy Duke's jocular holocaust. Figures, compiled from press reports in Britain alone, reveal this conservationist as targeting hare, wild duck, snipe, woodcock, teal, pigeon and partridge, commandeering English wildlife with lead shot. In 1993, at the royal family's Sandringham estate, shooting pheasant daily, often with his wife, the Duke hit a target of 10,000 during his 7 week stay. His Norfolk parties have now bagged 150,000. Should the Duke partially miss, then a bird he's wounded is brought by a gun dog to the royal group, where the Queen stands waiting with a convenient stick, and Her Majesty bludgeons it to death. Prince Philip especially enjoys shooting wild boar on the estates of friends in Germany. On one occasion, he and Prince Charles, wrote the Independent, are said to have killed 50 wild boar in a single day. Prince Philip frequently defends his love of blood sports by claiming that he's culling rather than killing all the wildlife he's dispatching, though to wildlife itself, it's a distinction without a difference. Alive to the importance of royal tradition, Prince Andrew first took his daughter out shooting when she was six. Perhaps the prince had told her about culling and killing, or perhaps he simply told her shooting was fun. Above all, he adores shooting rabbits, said a hunting friend of William's, shooting in the hills above Loch Muick, though the trainee royal's late mother said she was sorry her sons were, in her words, so keen on killing things. To Diana, they'd grown into a couple of little thugs who'd boast to classmates of Granny's castles. When I'm king, Prince William would say when thwarted, I'm going to send my knights around to kill you. If you give me a hard time, he told a schoolboy opponent, I'll get my dad to cut your head off. As if aware of some entitlement to adopt the serial killer Henry VIII as a murderous role model. They are never happier than when they have a gun in their hands, their mother noted, though warning them not to be photographed with guns. I told them, she said, remember, there is always someone in a high-rise flat who does not want you to shoot Bambis. Unfazed, Harry's accused of shooting owl-like hen harriers, of which there are only 700 breeding pairs, the bird's offence being to compete with humans in taking grouse, though the hen harrier only kills them to survive. Equally undeterred, Harry's elder brother spots an ibis, a bird revered in ancient Egypt, as the envoy of Thoth, god of words and of wisdom, when William is out hunting in Kenya. This slow, graceful bird, with a beak like a crescent moon, is considered an omen, but to William, it's a trophy, and he opens both barrels. But later, on learning it's endangered, says lamely, I was told they were good enough to eat. Royal killing sprees start young. Prince William would kill his first stag on his grandmother's Birkhall estate, aged 14, after which the head stalker, Sandy Masson, bloodied the boy in an initiation rite that followed the royal slaughter. Sadly, using a high-velocity rifle to size up a trophy stag with the telescopic sights adjusted for him by a gillie doesn't quite match the mystique of plucking a sword from a stone. So Merlin may have absented himself from this inaugural ritual. He may also have withheld his magic when Charles took William to Gloucestershire's Beaufort hunt and urged him to watch a kill. For the English fox, as native to Merlin's soil as its ancient oaks, may take precedence over Saxe, Coburg, Goths. We must not let daylight in upon the magic, warned Walter Bagot. The Victorian was fearful people might see through it. But royalists still strive to extend his warning to the present, though there's less magic in monarchy than ever. For just as with emperors and czars, the magic is manufactured. Royal figures with a high profile due to saturation publicity are people pretending to be state symbols and often go mad, in the same way zoo animals can die from being stared at. The present heir has famously said he'd wish to be reincarnated as one of his mistress's sanitary products, much as George III shook hands with a tree in Windsor Great Park, thinking he was speaking to the King of Prussia. Princess Alexandria of Bavaria said she'd swallowed a grand piano as a child, and believed this until she died. King Ludwig II of Bavaria would swear day was night and night was day, citing a moon he had painted on the ceiling as proof. Prince Otto, his younger brother, decided that the only way to keep his sanity while Ludwig was reigning was to shoot a peasant a day. So he shot them in the garden, then would wonder why his garden was overgrown. Catherine the Great locked up her hairdresser for over 3 years to stop him spreading the news she had dandruff. Prince Philip of Calabria was infatuated by pairs of gloves, wearing up to 16 pairs of silk ones at once. King Charles VI of France was convinced he was made of glass, and he'd refused to travel by carriage in case the wheel's vibrations caused his body to shatter into millions of transparent splinters. King Henry Christoph of northern Haiti liked forcing his royal guards to prove their loyalty by marching them off clifftops, while Henry executed those who refused. Queen Joanna of Spain went insane when her husband Philip died, and she wouldn't allow him to be buried, but had his coffin accompany her wherever she travelled, caressing his mummified flesh at mealtimes. King Ferdinand II of Sicily would only allow his face to be used on his mail services postal stamps on condition no franking mark was placed on his image, and all envelopes were handled with gloves. As if inhabiting the same ballpark, the Queens referred to dark forces at work in this country, of which we know nothing. And similarly, the doomed Diana thought, rightly or wrongly, that assorted agents of darkness were trying to kill her. This particular phase in my life is the most dangerous. My husband is planning an accident in my car. Brake failure and serious head injury in order, she'd write, to make the path clear for him to marry. As the royal brood mare, she felt trapped and betrayed, describing herself as a POW, or prisoner of Wales. Disgusted by her loveless marriage, she'd repeatedly throw up, revolted by the husband who'd rejected her. She produced an heir, as required, then a probable love child to restore her shattered self-esteem. Then she was tape-recorded, abused, and rejected some more. Whereupon, she went off the rails, or was pushed. Though her paranoia's unproven, rumour's wings can still flap, for those who rile the powerful as she did are at risk. Thus, Mike Mansfield, QC, points to Diana's crash as conveniently ending her opposition to the peddling of landmines. But from an ending rumours of conspiracy with undemocratic forces to the Queen's being a 12-foot lizard, these fables reveal the mental imbalance of those force-fed a remorseless diet of royal pap. Paranoid suspicions are a predictable byproduct of a plutocratic cult still ring-fenced by force of arms, a leftover from an empire in which murder was a commonplace, but whose embers retain their powers of destruction. Notably, when Trinidad became a dominion in 1962, a UK court was retained for its appeals, namely, the Judicial Committee of the Privy Council, and the Queen herself signs off the court's business. Though Britain would shortly abolish capital punishment, Trinidad's government maintained the practice, and the anomaly meant that the Queen approved death warrants referred to her from this judicial committee. Thus it is the case in the Caribbean, where Elizabeth is queen, in Belize, the Bahamas, Barbados, St. Lucia, and Jamaica, and in St. Vincent and the Grenadines, St. Christopher and Nevis, that a royal pen wields terminal power on death row.
What are your plans?
I am returning to Trinidad to liberate my brothers and sisters from the enslavement of the British colonialists.
What about the charges you are facing? How can you leave England?
They are liars and cowards. If they had anything against me but their fear of me, I'd be tried and jailed.
Thus, as a direct result, on the 16th of May 1975, in Royal Jail, Port of Spain, the prison superintendent arrived at a cell door at dawn, and he handed Michael de Freitas, the prisoner waiting inside, the dismissal of his last appeal, signed Elizabeth R. Michael was hooded, then led to the gallows under armed guard, and, while there's no death penalty in her own country, Michael was hanged by the neck by royal command until Michael X, also known as Abdul Malik, was pronounced dead. Years before, Michael had said that the monarchy would last longer if Her Majesty were to have a black baby. The British press were appalled, as they assumed his flip remark meant that Michael was offering his services as a stud. On death row, Michael fell to wondering if my chicaner caught me up. Then he'd say, with a fatalistic grin, So now I'm in a cell in her royal jail, and now it's her powerful royal noose that sends me to her kingdom come. Can you dig it? In his cage, a light bulb would burn throughout the night. We hear the flying of the trap, Michael told visitors, and he'd indicate the death chamber just a few feet away. Then he'd whisper, "We can hear it distinctly." He'd also hear a Lord Kitchener Calypso coming through the Death Row's Radio Macabre crackle. When the judge accept the verdict, he let the hammer bang. Malik, he say nothing, but Queen say one to hang. For in the words of Lord Diplock, the senior presiding judge, "Their lordships will humbly advise Her Majesty the appeal should be dismissed." His death warrant had been signed by the Queen on the 14th of May, 1975. And when what the monarch had thinkingly or unthinkingly signed had been conveyed to the Governor-General, Michael would say to his wife, Desiree, "Better go home. This is no place for you, pretty girl." In a manuscript smuggled out of Death Row, Michael described how, on a Wednesday, the voices of all the prisoners would acquire a higher pitch, for those in the cells lived in dread of an impending message from the Governor-General. Each week, Death Row's inhabitants were prepared for execution, which fell on a Friday. "You are weighed," Michael wrote. "The trap of the gallows is greased. All await the dreaded word. Greetings, if your time has arrived." Then, if it has, from the office at the far end of the corridor come some officials. They'll stand in front of your cell, and they'll salute you with this word from the Governor-General. Greetings. Everyone waits for that terrible word. Most times, hymns are sung. I pray, I hope someone somewhere will listen. For in all holy books it is written that justice should be tempered with mercy wherever possible. But there was no mercy for Michael, just a white hood. "If there is anyone in Trinidad who should get glory for my coming, Abdul Malik is that person," Muhammad Ali had said of Michael X, who'd invited him to see the conditions his people were living in. Then Allen Ginsberg wrote of a new awareness that we were all on the same boat of change, and of being armed to create Eden or Hell's fiery gardens on our little ball rolling through the solar system. Ginsberg added that Michael was part of that communal effort to work out our local destiny. "I pray with him that mercy be the last judge of the world, and not our own cruel, confused hearts." And in this context, and the context of his karmic nobility, I here plead for his life. Om ha hom. But with a pen stroke, the Queen showed she preferred Betjeman to the poems of Allen Ginsberg or Muhammad Ali. Kate Millett protested, "It's the hideous combination of racism and sexism that permits these kinds of trials to happen." Predictably, an appeal to the great-great-granddaughter of Queen Victoria, legendary for her stiff-necked views, such as, "Women's rights are a mad, wicked folly," were ignored, and all pleas to Buckingham Palace went unanswered, indicating that the head of the Anglican Church and the defender of the faith favours a more Old Testament view of religion. Thus, rather than Christ's revolutionary message of forgiveness, her governor's greetings brought revenge. Michael was hanged, then drawn, meaning he was left to swing, it being the royal jail's colonial tradition. In London, those who felt British hypocrisy had overreached itself wrote Michael's name on the walls of Buckingham Palace. Michael X, repeated 6 times, was followed by Michael Abdul Malik. But instead of an X, they added graveyard crosses. On the 6th of July, 1999, 25 years after Michael's death, the same royal custom persists with 9 executions in 4 days. Trinidad's prison commissioner, Cipriani Baptiste, told the press that the royal jail's gallows had been freshly oiled. The condemned, Joel Ram Singh, Stephen Eversley, and Bhagwandeen Singh, had once more been pricked by the royal Parker, as had Dol Chadi, Joy Ramaya, and Ram Kelawan Singh, Clive Thomas, and Robin Gopal, and Russell Sankarali. No human life, no matter how wretched, is without worth, said Sister Teresa D'Alva, a Catholic nun campaigning outside royal jail against the mass execution. The men are still human beings, children of God. The executions would take place despite appeals from Amnesty International and from 3 Nobel Peace Prize winners, including Bishop Tutu. It was as if the Parker Pen's owner, always above politics, felt empowered to strike through all pleas from the great and the good. But given that it's Her Majesty's Courts, Her Majesty's Prison Service, Her Majesty's Inspectorate of Constabulary, Her Majesty's Armed Forces, Her Majesty's Government, and taxes and subjects, being quite so inordinately majestic, could go to your head.
I'm just wild about Harry, and Harry's wild.
Prince Harry was sent to an Afghan war zone as political propaganda, and with the complicity of a prostrate press who agreed to enforce a news blackout till the MOD had fully exploited him to glamorize their country's war and attract recruits. Harry's bombs land on an area of Afghanistan in February 2008, and as Joint Terminal Attack Controller, Harry slaughters 34 Afghanis by using what's nicknamed Kill TV. He's then thought to have boasted of it in Bougie's nightclub. Codenamed Widow 67, Harry studies a regional map, pokes a finger at where the enemy's likely to be, then he instructs US air crews to blast Terry Taliban to smithereens, as if Afghan tribespeople were merely Norfolk pheasants. Again, if royalty was really above politics, the Queen wouldn't ask, as she recently did with a testy expression, why, she being so rich, no one foresaw the downturn in the economy. For it concerned her to be a fraction less wealthy. Compare all this to the royal reaction to the Pan Am disaster at Lockerbie, when 259 were killed. It was described as the largest mass murder on British soil, and it was taken for granted the sovereign would visit. But though the royal family happily used Scotland as its playground, as a base from which to decimate its wildlife, yet their jammed moral compass insisted their schedule was full, and so regretfully they'd give Lockerbie a miss. Although Edinburgh was Scotland's capital city, its Duke pleaded a prior engagement in Japan. Then the Queen and Prince Charles also made their excuses, though it was agreed Andrew might fit in an hour. The exploding Boeing airliner had gouged out a crater in Lockerbie's Sherwood Crescent, killing 11 residents with the plane's falling parts and injuring others with its impact explosions. Andrew deigned briefly to appear at someone's bedside, though only managing the dispiriting observation that this kind of thing was bound to happen sooner or later, and adding, for no reason, it's worse for the Americans. Andrew's family may be sealed off within their billionaire bubbles, but such a studied reluctance to comfort the afflicted must inevitably tempt Providence, if not the Greek Furies, always happiest when afflicting the comfortable. God save the Queen, the Sex Pistol spat venomously. Our figurehead is not what she seems. God save your mad parade, ran their incendiary song. God save the Queen, a fascist regime. God save the Queen, a fascist regime. Edward VIII would visit Nazi Germany in 1937 to meet Adolf Hitler. And later, he'd voice admiration for his policies. The Quondam King concluded, "It would be a tragic thing for the world if Adolf Hitler were overthrown." Following his elder brothers taking his honeymoon in the Third Reich, his successor, George VI, was also keen on appeasement. And he even sent a royal escort to congratulate Chamberlain on his flight back, after his being deceived by Hitler at Munich. Then, when George VI thought the empire was threatened by refugee Jews, King George VI gladly said he was glad to think that steps are being taken to prevent these people leaving their country of origin. His directive simply meant they'd die. Since following George's concern, the King's secretary, Halifax, would telegraph the British Embassy in Berlin, and Halifax asked them to encourage the German government to check the unauthorized emigration of Jews. So when it came to anti-Semitism, King George VI may not have stuttered at all. And even as late as 1970, his elder brother was telling interviewers, "I never thought Hitler was a bad chap." Edward's cousin, Prince Philip, had four sisters married to Nazis, yet was considered an eligible suitor for Princess Elizabeth, despite his family, in Philip's own words, being inhibited about the Jews, and despite Philip's featuring at Nazi funerals. In a family photograph, Philip's youngest sister, Sophia, is seen opposite Hitler at Göring's wedding, where every conceivable expression of racist excess would doubtless have been common currency. Philip's brother-in-law, Prince Christoph von Hessen, served both in the SS and the Luftwaffe. He was even suspected of having bombed Buckingham Palace in the hope of assassinating George and reinstating Edward. For in July 1940, while the exiled Edward was in Lisbon, the German ambassador had consorted with the former king. He then informed Berlin, "The Duke believes that continued heavy bombing would make England ready for peace." Thus an embittered Edward was urging the bombing of his own people, and with his wife, who'd had von Ribbentrop as a lover, and with his aide, Fruity Metcalf, a Mosleyite blackshirt, they'd treacherously plot his return as a royal Nazi puppet. After the war, Edward's collusion proved embarrassing, and so the Queen's cousin, Sir Anthony Blunt, an ex-Soviet spy, later in charge of the Queen's pictures, was asked to track down incriminating documents. Blunt was sent to the Schloss Friedrichshof in Kronberg to rescue Edward's Nazi correspondence. Then, thanks to Blunt helpfully concealing evidence of royal treason, Blunt's own brand of treason was granted immunity. Predictable, given his fascist flavouring, Philip's no stranger to genocide. "In the event that I'm reincarnated," Philip has said, "I would like to return as a deadly virus." Thinking his high-handed Karl would, in words, solve overpopulation. Such thoughts reflect a frequent hobby horse of the rich, who morbidly dwell on threats from the poor, though their poor's footprint is minimal compared with their own. Yet, they're targeted by plutocratic eugenicists.
I've danced with a man who starts with a girl who starts with the Prince of Wales. It was simply grand, he said, "Topping band," and she said, "Delightful, sir. Glory, glory, hallelujah. I'm the luckiest of females, for I've danced with a man.
He's bad-tempered, ill-educated, and probably won't be faithful, was reputedly the verdict of George VI on Prince Philip, whom George VI's wife would refer to as the Hun, singling him out for especial loathing. Prince Philip, who was first known as Battenberg, later anglicised to Mountbatten, in fact shared the original name Schleswig-Holstein, Sonderburg, Glücksburg, Beck, after the family's alma mater, a Prussian principality. But on advice, all these mouthfuls were downsized to the name Windsor, lifted from an English town and an English family, a ruse to deflect prejudice against intrusive Prussian princelings with a passion for large families and dead animals. Yet anglicizing an irksome past proves only a cosmetic ploy, as in the case of Princess Michael of Kent, formerly Reibnitz, an SS officer's daughter who was heard bawling at African Americans in a New York restaurant, "You need to go back to the colonies." Likewise, the Queen's sister, Princess Margaret, who was so royal that she'd sometimes answer the phone with the matchless phrase, "This is royalty speaking," as if expecting a long-distance curtsy. Huffley walked out of the film Schindler's List because she thought it was anti-German. It was a tedious film about Jews, she told her butler, and strongly advised him to give it a miss. The princess's views on any races or condition of men that differed from her own were distasteful. She told Chicago's mayor the Irish were pigs, all pigs, and as for India, she hated those little brown people. Despite Margaret's being the patron of a children's charity for the mentally handicapped, the princess rounded on one of its unit staff, saying, "I don't want to meet any daft children." Princess Margaret would parrot the views of the Queen Mother, an unabashed supporter of white rule. When daughter Margaret referred to the Rhodesian majority as either blackamoors or else nignogs. At the time, it was thought the pistol's accusations of fascism were outrageous and totally off target. Yet fascism, defined as corporate elitism plus violence, can shapeshift and adopt user-friendly disguises. Christmas paper crowns are worn by killing machines.
Room at the top, they are
as Lennon sang,
still.
There's room at the top. But first you must learn how to smile as you
first
kill.
First you must learn how to smile as you kill.
If you want to be like the folks on the hill.
If you want to be like the folks on the hill.
And the folks on the hill are rich beyond avarice. And they give their consent to any war going. Illegal, dishonest wars fought for ignominious profit. No royal figurehead ever says its wars are a lie. Instead, the firm is overindulged with media oxygen, leading to the looniest distortions of common sense, in which, for example, 1 in 10 primary school children in 2010 believed the Queen had invented the telephone. The sovereign can do no wrong, and no laws can be brought against her, according to Lord Halsbury in the Laws of England. But a democratic monarchy is an oxymoron, and as regards transparency, the royal drawbridge is invariably pulled up. Royal trivia gets saturation coverage. In April 2011, the BBC's lead story was the fact that William won't wear a ring. His father does, but his grandfather doesn't. This royal fetishism is passed off as news. In the US, 74 people earn the same as the bottom 19 million, thanks to which their society makes no sense. And royalty too bears this same economic mark of Cain. It makes claims on society through its irrelevant wealth. The royals run a Wonderland caucus race where the ignoble get prizes, such as a knighthood, for example, for Norman Schwarzkopf, the US general who said Iraq's dead weren't worth counting, and another knighthood for Kissinger, a criminal who swaggeringly proclaimed power was an aphrodisiac after he'd carpet-bombed Cambodia. "Why should we flagellate ourselves?" the dissembling Sir Henry likes to ask. "For what the Cambodians did to each other." I want every Iraqi soldier bleeding from every orifice, General Schwarzkopf would sadistically announce, after which the Queen gave this ghoul her greatest honor, following his genocidal bloodletting in U.S. wars. Other pillars of the American state join in the queue for rewards, royalty-mongering specters of the U.S. machine. Caspar Weinberger of the Iran-Contra Drugs for Arms Affair, and Brent Scowcroft, Kissinger's gopher, and now Knights of the British Empire. For services to law enforcement, J. Edgar Hoover, the head of the FBI, who had half of the Black Panther Party murdered, and who phone-tapped Martin Luther King for 10 years, is pleased to find himself similarly ennobled. As is Alan Greenspan, the financier who endorsed toxic derivatives to create a housing bubble, making the rich even richer. An economic war criminal who fetishized market forces. Sir Alan Greenspan's now a knight of the British Empire. The fact that each US president's record, without exception, would earn them seats in the dock at Nuremberg or at the International Criminal Court on genocide charges doesn't prevent the royal family from honoring them. For by an ironic twist, each president morphs into George III, against whom their forebears fought. They declare wars on a whim, they're tyrannical plutocrats, and they imprison their own people without trial.
Too many ideas. Not like you, Mr. Pitt. You don't have ideas. Yeah, well, you have one very big idea, balancing the books. And a very good idea it is to have, too. What? The best. And one with which I absolutely agree. As I agree with you, Mr. Pitt, on everything. Apart from the place we mustn't mention. The colonies.
They're now called the United States, sir.
Are they? Goodness me. The United States. Well, I haven't mentioned them. I prefer not to, whatever they're called.
But the US has been infatuated with a monarchist mindset from the US Republic's very earliest days. A crawling John Adams proposed they give their first president the fatuous title of His Exalted High Mightiness. So two presidents are made knights of the Queen's crooked table. George H.W. Bush Sr. and Ronald Reagan, both guilty of war crimes in Nicaragua and El Salvador, and misguidedly bombing Iraq and then Libya. Next comes Colin Powell, who presented some talcum powder to the UN, claiming it was anthrax and thus a pretext for war. Now Sir Colin is a knight, the man who covered up the My Lai massacre, the man who torched Vietnamese villages with his Zippo lighter. "We burned down the thatched huts," Powell confessed, starting the blaze with Ronson and Zippo lighters. Why were we torching houses and destroying crops? Ho Chi Minh had said his people were like the sea in which gorillas swam. We try to solve the problem by making the whole sea uninhabitable. In the hard logic of war, what difference did it make if you shot your enemy or starved him to death? Sir Colin Powell, supervisor of turkey shoots as Iraqi soldiers tried to retreat from Basra and were fried, betrayed Dr. King's nonviolence, preferring the craven acceptance of a bauble from Great Britain's Queen. Another royal investiture was held for the US General Tommy Franks, who oversaw the looting of hospitals in Baghdad and whose forces thought it fun to fire on Iraqi ambulances. Sir Tommy now joins these sorry knights of a twisted table. Where Kissinger is a knight commander of the most distinguished order of St. Michael and of St. George, though Sir Henry is neither angelic, nor has he killed any dragons, but he has only napalmed peasant farmers in fields. And should anyone be inclined to study Kissinger's nobility any further, he is so inured to genocide that he once advised Nixon, "If they put Jews into gas chambers in the Soviet Union, it is not an American concern." Yet, they're singled out by the monarch for aggrandizement. These characters, who've remained unchanged since the time of the Roman historian Tacitus, who said, "They plunder, they slaughter, and they steal." This they falsely name empire, Tacitus wrote on Rome's expansionist wars, adding, "And where they make a wasteland, they call it peace." His verdict is just as applicable to creatures from the same swamp millennia later. George V would even make knighthoods dictator-friendly by his bestowing one on Italy's Mussolini. Then Bomber Harris, Dresden's terror bomber, would receive the same honour, a serial war criminal by his own admission. Shimon Peres, the ethnic cleanser of Palestine's West Bank, who installed nuclear weapons at Dimona and who ordered the Qana massacre of children in Lebanon, Sir Shimon is made another Knight of St. George. But when monarchs give out their decorations to unashamed murderers, to whom no crime against humanity is too gross, a child might ask, as one did at a similar ceremony, "Mummy, what are those people for?"
Beauty I'd always miss, with these eyes before, just what the truth is, I can't say anymore.
To the revolutionary John Milton, the trappings of a monarchy would set up an ordinary commonwealth. And Shelley scorned monarchy as the string that holds a robber's bundle. He might have added that strangles its subjects. For, sat like a fat fairy on top of the arms trade's Christmas tree, it cynically profits from wars being the health of the state. And it has done so with the royal approval of a million dying in Iraq. For war's a royal hobby, as is killing animals for sport. Though, to let your own subjects be sacrificed to an illegal war, to allow them to be gulled by queen and country, to have hundreds of your subjects dying for a foreign empire, would not long ago have amounted to treason.
Charles Stuart, King of England, you have been found guilty of high treason against the good people of this nation, represented in Parliament, by whose authority this court does sit in judgment upon you. And upon this charge, it is the sentence of this court that you be taken hence to an appointed place and put to death by the severing of the head from the body. And that is the sentence of the whole court.
Charles I would be tried for having secretly treated with a hostile power, namely Spain. So a monarchy that's been prostituted by the US Empire has put itself in just the same position. For all its heritage bling and its armed ceremonial, it conceals a squalid capitulation, whereby England becomes a Disney Field landing strip somewhere to the right of Washington. There's people at this moment, warned the band Crass in a telling song, "The Gas Man Cometh." There's fingers on the trigger, there's loyalty and royalty to make their violence figure. "Get well soon," says Charles, stiltedly, to a half-incinerated soldier. And the war veteran replies, "Yes, sir, I will." And this tragic farce continues with lip service to our brave lads, the victims of a monarchy's class relations, and of politicians sloganeering "support the troops" when really meaning "support arms industry profits," a deadly doublespeak that serves to persuade young lives of their glorious duty to end up as state compost.
Sitting at this moment, fingers on the trigger. Rolls and rolls, it's a magnet by the finger. It leads to the flag, the silent of the prison door. It leads to the melody while the bombing
third choice. The space shuttle. If you can't not fight, from the camera on the airwaves, the whites are lit. Not for you and me, they'll turn up sick. I never face the night and we'll stand a squatting point. Touching it, mental health, but never end for life. Keep us all in love across the kids' laptops. If we stand against their power, see our violence grows. Read it in the paper, bet in front of your skills. You stand up to violence, then the hype is true. Dying line or by the cross. Think they care, even have a life love.
For while behind any fortune there lurks a great crime, this particular monarch is the beneficiary of dividends produced by an empire's corpse mountain, vast sums squirreled away without apology. It began with the royal namesake Elizabeth I licensing thieves to kit themselves out as predatory pirates for the purpose of raiding Spanish ships and plundering their contents, then bringing stolen gold to their pimping Gloriana. Thus, as Britain became rich, it wished to expand, using any pretext or deception to do so, such as declaring Ireland to be a barren wilderness so its inhabitants could be swept aside. As a result, royal favourites would receive tracts of land as plantations for Britain's cash crops, with the language and rights of the local population suppressed and killed off by the crown. In Ireland, Dublin's Dean Swift was prompted to despair that one half of all Irish rents is spent in England and is squeezed out of the blood and vitals of Irish tenants, who all live worse than any English beggar. As Britain increased its appetite for luxuries further, it would extend its foreign possessions. Then, being genteelly disdainful of dirtying its hands, it industrialized slavery as a solution. The defenceless and vulnerable were hunted down and rounded up by bribery and terror, sold on to the middlemen who traded in forced labour to produce the empire's new necessities. Royal palaces, paid for with slavery's products, sugar, tobacco, rubber, and tea, were built by England's own indentured labourers. King, emperors would then fill the palaces with the acolytes they'd ennobled, and all demanding to be treated like gods. The dark side of the British Empire grew murkier still, thanks to its late Victorian holocausts, in which 30 million died through the engineered famines that lasted 20 years in the Indian subcontinent. Due to the Empire's use of state-backed forced labour, a further 4 million died in Bengal's famine, thanks to a meanness that was built into imperial policy of refusing food to a feckless poor who'd breed. A free market ideology mixed with colonial callousness would lead to serial megadeaths. There were thousands more victims in Malaya and Africa, in British-owned mines and plantations. Men, women, and children had their lives cut short, killed or maimed in the lengthy construction of the imperial railways for transporting produce under the armed protection of imperial troops. The concentration camp was a British invention under Queen Victoria in the Boer War, and in her Indian camps, Her Majesty's officers would conduct proto-Nazi experiments. They were to see how few calories Indian coolies needed and still be able to perform hard labour. Such camps' rations were less than in Buchenwald, something imperial apologists forget. They forget, too, that their adored icons, such as Churchill, urged Britain to have its empire on the cheap through using aerial bombing, machine guns, and poison gas to suppress rebellions and unwelcome protest. "I do not understand this squeamishness," Churchill declared, "about the use of gas." And elsewhere he'd repeat, "I am strongly in favour of using poisoned gas against uncivilised tribes." Thus, poison gas was used on Iraq in the 1920s simply to secure oil for the British Navy, and Sudanese villages were trashed after World War I for objecting to Britain's control of the Nile. In India and the Middle East, every extreme method was used, merely to resolve labour disputes, or brutally to punish the non-payment of taxes to Britain during Gandhi's non-violent resistance. In the 1920s and early 30s, Mohandas Gandhi was enemy number one to Britain's King Emperor, whom Churchill advised will sooner or later have to be grappled with and finally crushed. It is alarming and also nauseating to see Mr. Gandhi, Churchill magniloquently announced, a seditious Middle Temple lawyer, now posing as a fakir of a type well known in the East. Striding half-naked up the steps of the Viceregal Palace, while he is still organizing and conducting a defiant campaign of civil disobedience to parley on equal terms with the representative of the King Emperor. Although the Mahatma was the equal of any King Emperor, his advice was ignored, and instead, Battenberg, aka Mountbatten, Prince Philip's uncle, invigilated Indian partition so hurriedly that it resulted in a million deaths and is still causing more. Then, in pursuit of its post-colonial economic goals, Britain has had direct responsibility for suppressing independence movements in Indonesia and for the bombing of Yugoslavia, for invading Iraq, yet again, for bombing Afghanistan, yet again, for waging war in Yemen, Egypt, and Iran, for supporting state killings in apartheid South Africa, and for backing the invasion of East Timor, for having funded General Pinochet's coup in Chile, and for Great Britain's so-called left arming the Nigerians in their war against Biafra solely to protect corporate oil. Worse still, counterinsurgency troops left England for Southeast Asia and covertly supported US crimes in Vietnam, blessed by royal colonels in chief. They then returned with a South Vietnam bar attached to their General Service Medal, though their government was dishonestly denying British troops were ever involved. Yet thus, and most shabbily, with the royal imprimatur, UK lives were sacrificed to American aims, to the US's Vietnam Holocaust, with its 4 million dead. The UK monarch fueled a fascist empire in Asia. And however you cut it, the sovereign was commander-in-chief of British Army death squads roaming Ireland, killing Catholics in collusion with the Ulster Constabulary and killing them with total impunity. Thus, if you factor in the suppression of Mau Mau and the castration of the Kenyan landless, plus the Aden killings of the 1960s and massacres of communist insurgents by the Scots Guards, if you factor in the decapitation of so-called bandits by Royal Marine commandos in Perak, and the bombing of Malaya during the so-called emergency, 4 centuries of this yields a body count of millions, while the benefit from such imperialist corpse-making has been enriching royal bank accounts. It's added multiple zeros to royal names or to their nominees at Coutts Bank or Rothschild's or at Barings. In exchange, royalty swans past, waving with lofty serenity, while it pretends that none of this happened. It promotes its trite fables while covering up financial gain, never apologizing for its investment's side effects. During the Raj, in the Punjab city of Amritsar, Britain's local panjandrum, a Brigadier General Reginald Dyer, issued 2 orders. One ordered all the Indians using the main street to crawl its entire length on their hands and knees, and the other authorized a public whipping for citizens of Amritsar who should find themselves within a lathi length of a British policeman. A protesting crowd gathered in Jallianwala Bagh, Amritsar's park, on April 13, 1919, where they listened to the testimony of victims, all of them unarmed and peaceable.
To take their anger.
Cavalry Major.
In front!
Shall we issue a warning, sir?
They've had their warning. No meetings.
Dyer appeared at the head of a large contingent of British troops. Then, without warning, he ordered his machine gunners to open fire. They pierced 2 and 3 bodies at a time. The shooting continued for a quarter of an hour until the ammunition ran out. It killed 379 people, all of them huddling together in fear.
General Dyer, is it correct that you ordered your troops to fire at the thickest part of the crowd?
That is so.
...1,516 casualties with 1,650 bullets.
My intention was to inflict a lesson that would have an impact throughout all India.
General, did you realize there were children and women in the crowd?
I did.
But that was irrelevant to the point you were making.
That is correct.
Could I ask you what provision you made for the wounded?
I was ready to help any who applied.
General, how does a child shot with a 303 Lee Enfield apply for help?
During Indian royal tours, monarchs have been invited by relatives of Amritsar's victims to say sorry. But each time the sovereign's advisers have huffily told them that apologies aren't what monarchy does best. Though eventually, in 1997, by arrangement with the Foreign Office, in an attempt to rebrand the empire as benign, both Her Majesty the Queen and the Duke of Edinburgh were persuaded to visit Amritsar's monument. There they would read on its commemorative plaque, "This place is saturated with the blood of about 2,000 Hindus, Sikhs and Muslims who were martyred in a non-violent struggle." The Duke, however, harumphed with indignation and turned on his heel as he said, "That's a bit exaggerated. It must include the wounded," and implied it was all beneath his notice. Royalty is now a dusty cherry on an imperial cake, left stranded as the empires receded, superfluous to requirements, and so stale and tasteless an heir once let slip, "I don't want to be king." Yet it persists, like an unlanced boil in the body politic, a musky legacy of accumulated atrocities, persistently cognizant of the sinister advice of James I's Chancellor. Democracy is the deadliest enemy to a monarchy. But while the UK's fake democracy shells out $100 million year in and year out for royalty's upkeep, Michael Fagin, who once broke into the Queen's bedroom, is celebrated in subversive songs as a hero. And it's significant that Iceland, Bermuda, Puerto Rico, and others are happy, not only without an indulgent royal family, but they also manage without having armed forces at all. No armies, nor any monarchs to extol violence. Sir Henry Kissinger, knighted by the Queen, has said, "Military men are dumb, stupid animals, to be used as pawns for foreign policy." And, like dutiful puppets, the Queen's soldiers are fed into US infernos. The United States of profiteers from perpetual wars is an ally, and whenever any of its plutocratic presidents yells out for cannon fodder for any of its imperial ventures, Little Britain subjects its citizens to the US's death wish. I don't dislike babies, though I think very young ones rather disgusting, said Queen Victoria, despite her imposing her multiple offspring on the country, who've made many of England's finest spirits throw up. The shades of Wat Tyler, of John Ball, Jack Cade and William Morris, of William Blake and Thomas Paine, of Mary Wollstonecraft and Shelley and Gerard Winstanley, all daily gag at monarchy's repugnance. How far kingships declined in a child's eyes can be gathered from Richard the Lionheart in Robin Hood's time, who, whether true or false, stood for a just and fair England, a far cry from cold landlords and profiteers, a far cry from the current reincarnations of King John, with his sheriff's hands in the till, from the tormentors of bears, birds and wild boar, from fox hunters slashing horses and shooting stags, glorified abattoir attendants dressing up their warfare state in military tat, grisly accumulators of diamonds and gold and weapons, judicial killers whose bejewelled fingers sign death warrants without a second thought for the consequences. I never wonder to see men wicked, said Jonathan Swift, but I often wonder to see them not ashamed. Yet thanks to the wonder of Hanoverian haughtiness, the word sorry loses its way before finding the royal lips.
This other Eden, demi-paradise. This fortress built by nature for herself against infection and the hand of war. This happy breed of men. This little world. This precious stone set in the silver sea, which serves it in the office of a wall or as a moat, defensive to one house against the envy of less happier lands. This blessed plot. This earth, this realm, this England, this nurse, this teeming womb of royal kings.
Shakespeare would now see a monarchy empty of atmosphere, with its magnetic pole shifted elsewhere, a royalty changed to heritage showbiz for the dull-witted, peddling packets of crested duchy biscuits, while hiding haughty tycoons, nonces, and bloodthirsty oafs, who take out their sorry inadequacies on creatures they judge to be their inferiors, if not vermin, while they themselves live off the labour of centuries. When the East India Company defeated the Maharaja of Punjab, the company presented to Queen Victoria the largest diamond ever to be discovered in the world. It was called the Koh-i-Noor. Later, Queen Victoria would take a sadistic pleasure in displaying the Koh-i-Noor to the Maharaja's heir on his visiting Buckingham Palace, and he would leave muttering, Mrs. Fagin.
Why should we break our backs, stupidly paying tax? Better get some untaxed income, better pick a pocket or two, you gotta pick a pocket or two, boys. You gotta pick a pocket or two.
The criminal Fagin's profession in Dickens's Oliver Twist was as a receiver of stolen property. But unlike royalty, who receives stolen property with impunity, Fagin's career would prove shorter-lived. Fagin was hanged at Newgate for his accumulated wealth, whereas the Queen continues to benefit from assets which were once stolen from Simon de Montfort and are now administered by the Duchy of Lancaster. De Montfort was a rebel who wished to expand democracy by undermining the power of the monarch, but such democratic concerns were rewarded by execution and the confiscation of his property by the Crown. However, de Montfort's corpse still produces dividends from his 20,000 acres in Merseyside the Crown seized, and further lands in Yorkshire, worth 72 million to the Queen, are exempted from capital gains and corporation tax. The Crown also benefits handsomely from what's quaintly known as the Duchy's Bona Vacantia and Bastardy Funds, a medieval mechanism whereby the Queen inherits the estates of all those in the duchy dying intestate. Thus, the Royal Fund would do surprisingly well as a result of the deaths of widows of soldiers who were killed in the Second World War, for their property would go to the very people who'd sent them to die. In the year 2000, more than £2.1 million was thus gleaned for Her Majesty the Queen's private income from 276 people from Merseyside in Lancashire. They'd made no will, so their property was grabbed. The estates of war veterans, the estates of the intestate, and also the proceeds of 232 companies dissolved in the year 2000, their assets went to this lovable queen, a billionaireess with an income from grave robbing. And the same is true for the Duchy of Cornwall. If you die without making a will, everything you possess will go to Prince Charles, to a billionaire biscuit maker plus duchess. Threadbare convention that it's unfair to attack such a family is altogether redundant, for they answer back continuously and perfectly plainly with an untouchable mountain of money. Tom Paine said hereditary power was as implausible as having hereditary mathematicians, and Ben Franklin compared monarchy to the potato, since any goodness, like old kings and queens, lay underground. The initial role of a king, deriving from the word kindred, was once to be the tribe's highest common factor. But when virtues traded for war profiteering and the rest, then its bubble can be said to have burst. In The Ancient Mariner, Coleridge wrote of a man doomed by his having killed an albatross. A similar curse attaches to the ibis, the slow, celestial bird revered in hieroglyphs for changing the tides. In Egypt, the moon god Thoth would appear as an ibis, and with his wife, Maat, Thoth made a cosmic egg. It was to feed the sun god with an harmonious essence, and its bounty would pervade and support creation. Eons later, a fake House of Windsor, a less magical fable, built on fly-blown genealogies, has to crumble, with its offspring being turned out of their gilded cages, allowing the wildlife they persecute to fly free. All things begin and end in Albion's ancient druid rocky shore. William Blake. Queen Elizabeth II, the largest landowner on earth. Queen Elizabeth II, head of state of the United Kingdom and of 31 other states and territories, is the legal owner of about 6,600 million acres of land, one-sixth of the Earth's non-ocean surface. She is the only person on Earth who owns whole countries, and who owns countries that are not her own domestic territory. This land ownership is separate from her role as head of state, and is different from other monarchies where no such claim is made, Norway, Belgium, Denmark, etc. The value of her land holding? 1,760,000,000,000 pounds, approximately. This makes her the richest individual on earth. However, there is no way easily to value her real estate. There is no current market in the land of entire countries. At a rough estimate of $5,000 an acre, and based on the sale of Alaska to the USA by the Tsar, and of Louisiana to the USA by France, the Queen's landholding is worth a notional $33 trillion. Her holding is based on the laws of the countries she owns, and her land title is valid in all the countries she owns. Her main holdings are Canada, the second largest country on earth, with 2,467 million acres, Australia, the seventh largest country on earth, with 1,900 million acres, the Papua New Guinea, with 114 million acres, New Zealand, with 66 million acres, and the UK, with 60 million acres. She is the world's largest landowner by a significant margin. The next largest landowner is the Russian state, with an overall ownership of 4,219 million acres and a direct ownership comparable with the Queen's landholding of 2,447 million acres. The third largest landowner is the Chinese state, which claims all of Chinese land, about 2,365 million acres. The fourth largest landowner on Earth is the federal government of the United States, which owns about one-third of the land of the USA, 760 million acres. The fifth largest landowner on Earth is the King of Saudi Arabia, with 553 million acres. Largest five personal landowners on Earth, Queen Elizabeth II, 6,600 million acres. King Abdullah of Saudi Arabia, 553 million acres. King Bhumibol of Thailand, 126 million acres. King Mohammed IV of Morocco, 113 million acres. Sultan Qaboos of Oman, 76 million acres. From www.whoownstheworld.com. There is more stupidity than hydrogen in the world, and it has a longer shelf life. Frank Zappa.